Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Grace Lutheran Church's live stream worship service. I'm Pastor Christian McMullen, the interim pastor here at Grace, and it is a pleasure to welcome all of you out there in internet land who are worshiping with us this morning. It's a pleasure to be able to do this. So let us continue our worship with the confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God,
you search us and know us.
You are acquainted with all our ways.
We confess our hearts are burdened by sin. Our own sins and the broken systems that bind us.
We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love.
We distrust those who are not like us.
We exploit the earth and its resources and fail to consider generations to come.
Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone.
Even before the worlds are on our tongues,
You know them.
Receive them in your divine mercy.
Amen.
How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Jesus Christ, our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace.
Amen. Amen.
Our gathering song is Here I Am, Lord.
The Lord of the Lord has come. a feast for them, my hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard your calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you'll lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, most merciful Redeemer, for the countless blessings and benefits you give. May we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day praising you, with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us now turn our attention to the reading of God's Word.
Our reading is from 1 Samuel, the third chapter. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." He said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again, a third time. And he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go lay down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for you, your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Then the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears it of it tingle. On that day I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore, I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever." Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son." He said, "Here I am," Eli said. "What was it that he told you?" Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all that he told you. So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. Then he said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
Our gospel reading this morning is from John chapter 1.
Praise to you, Lord.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses and the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
So there are a lot of directions I could go in for this sermon. So what I'm going to try to do is hit a lot of different notes and try to connect them around the gospel reading. So it's the call of the disciples. And the amazing thing about these passages where Jesus calls his disciples, he says, "Follow me," and Philip follows. Now, John says that he's from the same town as Andrew and Peter, who are called in the passage right before this one. So maybe Philip knows Andrew and Peter. Who knows? Now, Andrew was one of John the Baptist's followers. And so John the Baptist pointed Andrew in the direction of Jesus. So what was it that was causing Andrew to look? What was Andrew looking for? What was he out in the wilderness? What led him to the wilderness to John the Baptist? Was he looking for something? Is Philip, is he looking for something? I think people are looking all the time for something. Clarity, an answer, looking for reassurance, a plan, something to take away the anxiety and the uncertainty, a chance, a second chance, forgiveness, people looking for hope and a vision, people looking to follow, people looking to follow someone or something to take them out of themselves. Was Philip looking for something that made him so responsive to Jesus' call? Who knows? Did he know about Jesus ahead of time? John doesn't say. So what do we take away from the fact that Philip just dropped everything? Was he depressed? Was he bored? Was he angry? Did he need and want a change? And what was it about Jesus that led Philip to then go get Nathanael and say, "We found the Messiah"? And then you have Nathanael, whose first words out of his mouth are, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" I mean, that's just plain old basic prejudice. And then instead there's this cryptic comment about being under the fig tree and an Israelite in whom there's no deceit. Who knows what all that's about? But either way, Jesus has a way of knowing something. Jesus has a way of knowing something we don't, that only the people in the gospel know. So we have no idea what's going on in this story, but Jesus knows, and the people in the gospel know, like the fig tree, or the Samaritan woman at the well in John 4 with her five husbands and her current husband, who's not her husband. Maybe that's why they follow. That Jesus knows stuff about us that only we know. Jesus knows stuff about us that only we know. And it's those things that make all the difference in our lives. There are some things that only God knows because God's the only other one present in those things. It's kind of like, I don't know, there's some things that only us and God know about ourselves, about our lives, whether it's our cries, our pain, our joys, or those moments where God kind of breaks in. Light bulbs go off. That's that epiphany idea. Is that why we follow? Really, really follow. Because there's something about the message that touches us, whether it's a deeply held conviction or a sense of rightness or something else. Or do we follow because other people we trust follow? Now, the cynic would say that we're just a bunch of sheep and easily manipulated and lied to for a whole variety of purposes. But Jesus, the Good Shepherd, doesn't do that. He never lies to us. If anything, he's a little too blunt. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the good news. If any want to become my followers, they must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow. How many of you really want to follow that? Well, yes. Because along with that bucket of cold water dumped on our head are all those miracles, all those things that only Jesus can do. And therefore, we come to him hoping and trusting that he will do for us only those things that he can do. That's faith, in my opinion, at its most basic. Going to Jesus and trust for only those things that he can do. Meanwhile, he says, follow me. Put yourself aside enough, Jesus says, and come follow me. Because with that invitation to follow is also a vision. A vision. Death and resurrection, dying and rising. Yeah, you take up your cross and you lose your life, and then we end up finding it. Angels ascending and descending upon Jesus. He's a living connection and a bridge to heaven, to ultimate reality, to God. Not some connection that we sort of grasp with our minds, but this connection between heaven and earth is him. God come down in humanity. And to follow is simply to trust him. To say, hey, you know, I want to be around that guy. I think we all want the, you know, find my life part, but without having to go through the losing it part. But I think the thing that kind of leads us to even do that in the first place is the vision. The vision that that guy has. When it comes down to it, I think that's the part that hooks us. That really makes us say, I want to be a part of that. In the Old Testament, it's interesting how they paired that reading with Samuel. In the Old Testament, that vision was God's word. Visions were rare. You know, you read through the Old Testament, oftentimes that vision and that word of God come with judgment, that come to call clean, that call to come clean. But it was also a living connection with God, the one who freed and liberated them. So this vision, you know, this vision and this discipleship, this following Jesus, you know, I think about the last couple years, and boy, has it been interesting. I'll be a blunt, I'll be honest. You know, almost 3 years ago, hey, Christian, you want to go to Pottstown? I have to admit, I kind of wondered, can anything good come out of Pottstown? And then, being at two churches, I got to admit, I kind of wondered, can anything good come out of, you know, serving at two churches? Trying something new in ministry, stuff I've never done before, stuff y'all have never done before. I bet y'all may have wondered the same thing. Can anything good come out of this? But Jesus knows stuff about us that only he knows. And he calls us to follow whether we're ready or not. He calls us to follow before we've come clean. He calls us because he wants to give life to us. He wants to give us life. Through serving others, through serving him. You know, I also think that with Jesus' call to follow, that happens in the midst of circumstances we might not like or question or we wonder about. But there's still a vision that keeps us going that says, yes, something good can come out of Nazareth. Yes, something good can come out of doing ministry here, now, in these circumstances. Yeah, I'd say that'd be like when I think about it, that's probably the biggest takeaway. And I've heard and seen that in y'all's voices and faces. That yes, something good can come out of all of this. Yeah, there might be times when we doubt and want to be proven wrong, where we search and we don't find, where we wait and hope and pray for Jesus to find us under the fig tree. We're in the car, we're at our work, we're in the kitchen putting away dishes. And every time that I've had those doubts myself, God's proven me wrong. And I don't just mean about the ministry here in Pottstown, I mean just in general, but I want to specifically, even about, you know, this experiment. Every time I've done that, taken that step back, and when we do that, we lose our preconceived notions, open ourselves to follow without all the answers. Because that's the other thing that's really kind of characterized the last couple years is, gee, you know, will this work? I don't have the answer to that. I don't know. How many times have I said I don't know over the last couple years? A lot. But over and over and over again, that call to follow, that vision, God proves us wrong over and over again. Because he's simply calling us to follow. In the context of these passages, that's the thing I'm going to miss the most. Y'all and the vision God has for your ministry. Now, to sort of bring it up even to the present even a little bit more. The big challenge in the last year has been how to have a vision, how to see God's vision in the midst of a pandemic, how to follow, where we have to ask and figure out, you know, what does it mean to follow Jesus when we can't even leave our homes? And the circular thing is that we come to know Jesus and his grace most fully when we follow. If we say, well, gee, Jesus, I want to know you. He says, follow me and you'll know me. And then we follow him, and of course we learn to know who he is. We learn what grace is. A lot of us, I think, want to know all the answers before we jump in. Or we want to know what we get out of it. But we can't know that. All we can know is to hold on to Jesus' promise that there's new life and new resurrection. And what are we going to get out of it? We're going to get those things. But we'll lose our lives in the process. And we can't know any of that unless we follow. Jesus gives us a basic vision of who he is and how we can serve others in our community. Real basic. And then we fill in the rest. Love your neighbor. Love God. Amen. With the whole church, let us confess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Beautiful. Once again, I want to thank all of you out there who have supported the church's ministry in this time of pandemic when we can't worship together in person. Thank you to all of you who've mailed in your offerings and have given online. I'm filled with a sense of gratitude for y'all's support of the ministry here, and it makes a huge difference. So thank you. Let us pray. O God, receive these gifts as you receive us, like a mother receives her child with arms open wide. Nourish us anew in your tender care, and empower us in faithful service to tend to others with this same love. Through Jesus Christ, our saving grace.
Amen.
Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. We pray, O God, for the body of Christ gathered throughout the world, and for all servants of the gospel, that following Jesus, the church may live out its calling every day. We pray especially for the body of Christ gathered here in this community. Help us to trust you in the midst of change, to follow you even in the midst of uncertainty. Give us strength and faith and grace that we might hold on to you and your vision. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
We pray, O God, for the well-being of creation, for the world that you have blessed us with. We ask and pray, O God, that you would help us to be good stewards of the earth so that future generations might also reap its blessings. We pray for all of those who are hungry and thirsty. Help us to share our resources with those who are lacking. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
O God, you are the God of nations, and we pray for our nation, that we may be united around a shared understanding of the common good. We pray especially for President-elect Biden as he is inaugurated this week. We pray for all of our elected leaders. We ask and pray, O God, that we might be good citizens, advocating for each other and speaking the truth in love. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
We pray, O God, for those lacking food or shelter, for those who are grieving or sick, for those who are imprisoned or homebound. We pray especially for those on our prayer list and the ones we name before you now, whether silently or aloud. Dale, Richard, George. We pray, O God, that you would grant them healing and wholeness. We pray for all of those suffering from the coronavirus and especially those who care for them. We eagerly await, O God, the vaccine and ask and pray, O God, that the pandemic may end soon. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
We pray for our neighborhood, for visitors joining us for the first time, whether online or even in person, for those returning, wanting to hear your word and to find a vision. We pray for those absent from our assembly, that all who seek to know God are nourished by word and sacrament. We pray that you would grant those visitors a vision of you and open us to receive their vision. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
In thanksgiving for the saints who have gone before us, especially Martin Luther King Jr., whose birth we celebrate this week, we pray that their lives would give us a vision of the gospel in action. We especially pray, O God, that through King's witness, we might work for racial reconciliation. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray together our Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
God the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus the Beloved, fill you. the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, keep you in peace.
Amen.
Our sending song is, Will You Come and Follow Me?
Will you come and follow me if I but call your name? Will you go where you don't know and never be the same? Will you let my love be shown? Will you let my name be known? Will you let my life be known? Yourself behind if I call your name. Will you care for cruel and kind and never be the same? Will you risk a hostile stare? Should your life attract or scare? Will you let me answer prayer in you? Will you let the blinded see if I but call your name? Will you set the prisoner free and never be the same? Will you kiss a leper clean and do such as this unseen and admit to what I mean? Will you love the you hide if I don't call your name? Will you quell the fear inside and never be the same? Will you use a faith you found to reshape the world around? My sight and touch and sound in you and you in me. Lord, your summons echoes true when I call my name. Let me turn and follow you and never be the same. In your company I'll go, where your love and footsteps show. Thus I'll move and live and grow in you,
and you
in me.
All right, good morning again. Announcements. I don't really have a whole lot of announcements that I can think of off the top of my head. Still doing Bible study Wednesday night. This Wednesday will be our last one because I'll be moving on to a new interim call in a week, a little more than a week. I've really enjoyed it. And if you don't believe me, you can talk to Phyllis because Phyllis has been coming. Right, Phyllis? Yeah, there you go. Anyway. So Bible study, 6:30. Congregational annual meeting coming up. Mark it on your calendar, January 31st. It'll be immediately following the worship service. The COVID task force will be meeting on Monday the 25th, and we'll reevaluate when and how we might come back into worship in person. So, again, keep your ears peeled for that. Let's see, congregational council members needed. Yes, you know, picture, you know, that poster with Uncle Sam pointing the finger saying, you know, we need you. That would be, you know, picture Jesus pointing his finger saying, we need you. In other words, follow me. Wow, that just tied in my sermon, didn't it? So think about it, pray about it. Council's one of those, it really is a good experience. Yes, the meetings might be long, and yes, you know, Rich might pull out his non-existent hair when he was on council. I just, you know, how you pull out your hair, and I'm looking at Rich, and he's bald, so I'm like, anyway, no, it's rewarding. It is rewarding. So anyway, please think and pray about that. Let's see, I have one last announcement. Are there any other announcements before I move on? Anything I'm forgetting? All right, my last announcement is a sad one. My time as y'all's interim is finishing up. It hasn't fully sunk in yet for me. I'm sure it will, you know, in a few weeks or so. I have really enjoyed being y'all's interim pastor, and I will miss y'all. I always try to keep in mind those things that God's calling us to do, which means I'm always mindful of what I didn't get done and the possibilities of things that can be done. And if there's one thing that I want to encourage y'all with, it's that sense of possibility. So my last Sunday with y'all is the 24th, which is a week. So I'll say goodbye then, and I'll shut up right now. Okay. Go in peace, serve the Lord, following Jesus, wearing your face mask, staying 6 feet apart.
Thanks be to God.